welcome to Occidental College. My name is Ella Turin, and I'm Assistant Dean for Community Engagement here at Occidental College. And my job here, I'm a little biased, but I think I have the best job on campus. I get to connect our students and our faculty and our administrators and staff to the community, to projects related to social justice, to social change. And that's why you can see this event fits perfectly. So it's really excited to host all of you here. I love when we can have opportunities to bring more folks to campus and to engage in conversation and dialogue and do some critical thinking. So thank you so much for coming out tonight on a Friday night and joining us here. And of course, you're in for a treat. You all know who you're here to hear, so I won't stand too far between you and our guest of honor. But it's really wonderful to have Professor Wolff back here. This is the second time that we've hosted him here, maybe more than that before I got here. But it's really wonderful to have you back and to have you have all of this energy surround us because of your visit. And I have to say, because we're fellow New Yorkers and bonded by this, it's really wonderful to be in the presence of such a brilliant mind, someone who is bold in his thinking and his analysis of what's going on in the world, but also somebody who's very down to earth and approachable and really funny. And I very much appreciate that about him. I would just like to thank our partners, the ACLU, for approaching us and always partnering us with us on these events, and also Professor Wolff's organization, Democracy at Work, and of course LA Progressive, Dick and Sharon Price, for being such wonderful partners. In the past several years, we've really developed a relationship in which we think together and try to bridge as many events both here and in other places. And I think this is important. This is the work of the college, to not only educate our students, but to engage in public dialogue about what's going on in our world. So it's really an honor and a privilege to be able to do that. And so without further ado, I would like to introduce Hector Viagra, who is the executive director of the ACLU of Southern California. So enjoy the talk. Thank you.
Good evening. It's my honor to be the executive director of the ACLU of Southern California. It's my honor to be one of the co-sponsors for tonight's event. I think you're really going to enjoy the discussion tonight. Since the ACLU, the national organization, was founded in 1920, its focus has been on protecting and promoting the Bill of Rights, making sure the government values and respects the inherent dignity and autonomy of every individual in the United States. The ACLU of Southern California is the oldest local affiliate of the ACLU. It was founded in 1923. And you may not know this, but the roots of the ACLU of Southern California lie in the labor movement, the effort to defend the rights of workers to organize, to assemble, to speak out, and to advocate for better wages and working conditions. In fact, Upton Sinclair helped found the ACLU of Southern California after he was arrested for participating in a rally supporting striking dock workers. The LAPD had arrested 600 striking longshoremen in San Pedro and banned them from holding public meetings in Los Angeles. At the rally, Sinclair tried to read aloud the text of the First Amendment. And that was his way of showing his support for the workers' rights. As someone held a candle as the sun was going down, Sinclair said not a word about the workers. Instead, all he tried to do was simply read from the Bill of Rights. He got as far as the first three lines of the First Amendment before he was arrested. In arresting Sinclair, the police famously told him, and sometimes you have to give them credit for writing stuff that no one else could imagine writing for them, they literally said to him, "Cut out that Constitution stuff." Sinclair handed the Constitution to a friend of his, the Bill of Rights to a friend of his, who then picked up where he left off. He was promptly arrested, and they kept doing this in serial. And ultimately, six or seven of them were arrested, and they were charged with criminal syndicalism. In effect, for agitating to overthrow the government of California and the United States. In the years since, we've always remembered and stayed true to our roots. And one key way is by making economic rights central to our work. The ACLU of Southern California was the first ACLU affiliate to commit to an economic bill of rights. And we did that way back in 1983. The past 33 years, with wealth inequality reaching levels that we haven't seen since the Roaring Twenties, have only strengthened our commitment. We believe that economic rights and civil liberties and civil rights are inextricably intertwined. Without basic economic security, many people cannot fully exercise their civil liberties and civil rights. Without a measure of economic independence, true individual freedom is threatened. Ours is supposed to be a society of liberty and justice for all, where every individual has the same unalienable right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. But what happens when good schools, safe housing, basic health care, and decent employment are simply non-existent for millions? Or when poverty robs many Americans of the economic power, the psychic and physical security, and the practical ability to enjoy and to exercise their rights and participate fully in society? A mother working two jobs just to make ends meet finds it very difficult, if not impossible, to exercise their rights of assembly and speech. A child who is homeless and hungry finds it difficult to concentrate at school, do his homework, and ultimately make the most of his opportunity to receive an education. A man arrested and charged with a crime is taken from his family, taken from his home, taken from his community, and his job, his livelihood, his ability to support his family is jeopardized if he doesn't have enough money to pay for bail. We believe that the government can and should do more to guarantee basic human needs and make civil liberties and civil rights meaningful for everyone. The government is given by our Constitution, by us, the people, all the power that it needs to protect and promote our well-being. It just won't use it. We believe that our commitment to economic rights simply reaffirms our commitment to equal protection and fair treatment of everyone. And the need to reaffirm this commitment, for all of us to reaffirm this commitment right now, is extreme. We see this really clearly here in California. California is, at the same time, the richest state in the nation. We have more millionaires than any other state in the country. But California is also the poorest state. We have more people in poverty and more children in poverty than any other state. California has the highest percentage of its population living below the poverty line, a staggering 24%. Almost one in four children now live in poverty in California. But if you take a slightly broader definition of poverty, if you look at households that have incomes of 200% or less of the federal poverty line, and just to give you an idea, that's $23,000 a year for a family of four, the number jumps to about one out of every two children in California living in poverty. And our poverty rate has been increasing at a staggering rate, seven times faster than the rest of the country. And yet, even as the economy collapsed, the recovery stalled, and poverty has grown, California has managed to cut the social safety net. Since 2008, California has cut more than $15 billion from vital programs that serve and protect our most vulnerable: children, families, seniors, and people with disabilities. What's the result? It's entirely predictable. The number of childcare and state preschool slots has decreased by one quarter since 2008. California's per-student spending lags the rest of the country by a greater margin than at any point in the last four decades. UC and CSU fees have more than tripled since 1982, and that's even after adjusting for inflation. CalWORKS, which provides cash assistance to needy families, the purchasing power of CalWORKS grants has dropped by more than half since 1989. California spending per Medicaid enrollee is the lowest in the country, and California has the lowest percentage of doctors accepting Medicaid patients. So what do we do at the ACLU of Southern California to promote economic rights, to promote economic justice? We fight for a fair state budget. The budget is a key focus for our economic rights work because budgets are about choices and priorities. They tell you everything about what we as a society value and what we don't value. So we fight against cuts to health and human services programs that adversely affect the ability of children, seniors, disabled people, and low-income people to fulfill their most basic needs for food, for clothing, for shelter, for medical care. And we fight not only to stop future cuts, but we fight to restore all the funding that's been taken out of the system over the last few decades. We support reforming commercial property taxes and closing loopholes that keep corporations from paying their fair share. We support living wage and paid sick days for all employees in California. We do all of this work because we know that from infant mortality rates to employment options, from opportunities for education to likelihood of incarceration, from the cradle to the grave, economic inequality affects how we live and when we die. And we do all this work out of a profound conviction that economic rights are fundamental to political liberty and justice. And we do this work because we believe that as Americans we have certain obligations to each other, and that the perfection and the perpetuation of this union that we have all entered into depends on ensuring liberty and justice for all. We ask that if you support these principles, and I think that every person really should, we ask that you support the ACLU and help us promote these initiatives. So without further ado, I present tonight's keynote speaker, Professor Richard Wolff. Thank you.
I want to thank you all for coming. Thank Occidental College for hosting me yet again, for the ACLU with that fine rendition of good arguments, for your support for what they do. And I want to thank so many of you who made very nice comments to me as I was standing in the hall a few minutes ago about the radio program that I produce each week that your nodding heads now indicate that you listen to, which is very encouraging. It's the most important thing that I can hear to keep going what we're doing. Let me begin by telling you how enormously different the situation is now than even it was a year ago when I last, and I believe it was in this room, in this auditorium, that I spoke here. The year 2016, I suspect, no one knows for sure, is going to be a big year of change. Big year of change. Some of which will be scary in ways that I am going to try to summarize. The best title for my talk, and we've been agonizing over this, is the following: Signs of Crisis, which is the first half of what I want to talk to you about, and Signs of Change. But the really biggest change is what I'm going to tell you now, which is, this is the first time that I have given a big talk so far this year. Still early in 2016, and there's more change going on in the United States than I expected to see in my lifetime. And I mean change that makes me happy. I give a lot of talks around the United States, and I try with humor and other techniques to soften the impact of what I have to explain, since what I have to explain is often painful to hear. So it's wonderfully pleasant for me to be able to say that there are changes going on in the United States that are very deep and I think irreversible. And they are moving in a direction that I had long hoped for and did not expect to see in my lifetime. So I am feeling better than I have in a long time, and I'm going to try to explain to you how and why that is. So let me start. A very famous and very effective political leader once responded to his fellow members of his movement who had complained that the mass of people that they were trying to organize was hard to organize, that people complained and were unhappy, but they didn't do anything, and decade after decade went by. And so he responded to them and he said, "You know, it's true. For decades, nothing happens. And then in a few weeks, decades happen. I think we're in a few weeks. I think that's what's happening, and I think 2016 is going to show us a great deal more. And for those of you that might be saying, well, that's all very nice and good, but my neighbors and my friends and my relatives think everything is going along just as it always did, and nothing's happening. Well, for them, I want to tell another story before I launch into my analytics. And it's a story that comes from a famous book that maybe some of you read. A young journalist, fresh out of Harvard College, back in 1917, by the name of John Reed, happened to be a correspondent in Leningrad in Moscow in the autumn of 1917, when the Russian Revolution exploded. And he wrote a famous book about his weeks in those cities during the middle of the revolution. It had a very famous name called 10 Days That Shook the World. And there's a wonderful scene in this book where he describes the wealthy of Leningrad in their coaches, because they didn't have cars yet, drawn by horses, the coaches taking the rich to the opera. And they clattered by in all of their finery in the coach to the opera, even as the returning soldiers from the war, the army of Russia, were coming back to become soldiers, not of Russia, but of Lenin, Trotsky, and Stalin, into making the revolution. The revolution was exploding, but for a good number of people, it was opera as usual. They didn't see it. They didn't guess at it. They were overwhelmed. In New York City, where I live, a very clever fellow owns a storage business. In New York City, we can't have those kinds of storage units that you see sometimes in the country, those single-story things. So we have storage, but it's vertical. Somebody takes an old building and converts it into storage lockers. And he's made a fortune out of this. But it gives him buildings all over New York, and he uses the sides of the building to do advertising, and he's a radical. And so on the sides of the buildings, you see it all over New York, there's a huge sign which reads as follows. The French aristocracy didn't see it coming either. Very clever. And you, as you walk down the street, you listen to people on the streets of Manhattan who look at the wall, they all understand it immediately. No one needs to explain that. It is so beautifully written that everyone just, in a quiet way, nods. They get the message. And that's really the message I want to spell out for you this evening. So first, the signs of crisis. I have a lot to go over, so bear with me if I do it fairly quickly. The first sign of economic crisis has to do with something that's been going on now for 40 years, but is very poorly understood. It goes like this. Capitalism, the biggest industries, the biggest capitalist enterprises in the world, and most of those are located in Western Europe, North America, and Japan. They have decided, and I'm going to use strong language because I have a limited amount of time and I have to drive these points home. They have decided to abandon the places in which they grew. They've left. They've kissed us goodbye, using the term kiss loosely. They're gone. Those who haven't left yet are planning. They went for a simple reason. It's more profitable. It's basically why they do everything that they do, because that's what they're there to do. You cost too much. And there are loads of people out there in the world desperate to have your job and to do it for half of what it costs to pay you. So they're gone. Some experiments were made in bringing poor workers, low-income workers here. because that's the other way to get the same job done. You can save money by bringing the poor here. This causes too much trouble, too much tension, too much opposition. So you take the alternative step, you go over there. Or you do a little of both. But what you do is you abandon the people, the communities where you grew up, who sustained you from a little company that you started 100 years ago, 50 years ago, 30 years ago, and built up. You don't care what happens to those families, what happens to those workers, what happens to those communities. You just don't care. Your focus is somewhere else. You're building up the business now in Shanghai, or in New Delhi, or in Dhaka, Bangladesh, or any of the other places to which they've gone. That's where your focus is. That's where you care. Your future is over there. Your past is here. You're going to spend more time making sure the drinking water is safe in Bangladesh, and forget about the drinking water in Flint, Michigan, because you're not there anymore. There's nothing left in Flint, Michigan. Who cares? Yes, it was this or that mistaken leader and this, but you always have to explain why those mistakes are made. Flint is a suburb of Detroit. Detroit's the biggest example of the abandonment we can think of. It's an abandoned, decrepit, it's the largest urban bankruptcy in the history of the United States. Detroit, Flint, Cleveland, Camden, New Jersey. I could go on, and you know too. It's an abandonment of the United States. It's an abandonment of Western Europe, and it's an abandonment of Japan. Europe and Japan are now economic basket cases in many ways, because they don't know how to cope with this. They can't do what the United States does, come down on the mass of their people in ways I'm going to show you. They can't in Japan because of a certain kind of tradition, and they can't in Europe because the power of the communist socialist parties and the trade unions is simply too strong. The Americans don't have that problem. They don't have either of those problems. How did they handle this leaving of the United States? Well, it meant that the jobs disappeared here. It meant that the purchasing power of Americans shrank. They couldn't buy stuff because so many of them were losing their jobs. Basically, two adjustments were made. One was to say to the American people, tough. Please now, and I'm speaking here on behalf of these corporations, please get used to much lousier jobs at lower pay, with fewer benefits, and no security. Learn to enjoy the concept of life as a barista. It's very American, you know. If you give a sexy name to something, it becomes more acceptable. Nobody wants to be a bus driver, but if instead you are a transportation engineer, it sounds better. But that really wouldn't have done it, much as we are interested in these titles. So the way we got through the last 30 or 40 years was actually completely different. The solution, very important, was debt. It's very important that you all understand it. This economy should have begun to disintegrate 40 years ago, as the jobs disappeared, as the abandonment by capital was underway. Moving to China, moving to India, moving to Brazil, all those other places. But it didn't happen. It was postponed. And the way it was postponed was allowing you, the American people, to keep buying stuff to sustain the illusion that you lived in an economy that wasn't falling off a truck by buying everything on credit. Look at our history. 40, 50 years ago, the only major kind of credit that Americans had was their home, mortgage credit. Since then, we've added car payment credit. You buy your car. Since then, we invented, in the 1970s, the mass credit card. Before that, only business travelers had an American Express card. Now you all have 14 Visas and MasterCards and all the rest. And when that wasn't enough to load up the American people, you all know, and boy, this is the right audience to remind you all, we invented student debt. Another way to load you up with debt. Unbelievable what was done. First time in history that getting a college education plunged an entire population into levels of debt that everyone knows are unpayable. Everybody knows who pays attention to these things knows that the American student debt cannot and will not be paid. Like everyone knows that the debt of Greece cannot and will not be paid. And that the debt, basically, the debt of Ireland and the debt of Portugal and a half a dozen other countries will not be paid. The only question is how to manage this. Oh, I forgot one. Puerto Rico. Puerto Rico, which is now being reduced to rubble. Puerto Rico is Detroit all over again. And of course, being Americans, we have to recognize that Detroit is black and Puerto Rico is Hispanic. And if you think that's an accident, then you haven't been paying attention real well to American history. Puerto Rico, the poorest part of the United States, now has the highest sales tax in the country. You can't make this up. I'll say that again. 3.5 million people in Puerto Rico, poorest part of the United States, has the highest sales tax. And they're busy now figuring out other ways to screw those people. Okay, you built up the debt. Well, it doesn't take very long to understand that if the wages of the American working class are going nowhere, which they haven't for 40 years, because the jobs are disappearing, the good ones, and either you have no job or you have a job that's much less well paid. So the wages are going nowhere, but the debts keep rising. You do not need a PhD in economics. I have one, but you don't need it. You don't need it to understand that that can't go on. You can't have more and more debts when the underlying capacity to repay them isn't going anywhere. A day will come when the debts have gotten so big that you have to declare, I can't pay. We call that the 2008 crash. That's when the American people basically turned to the lenders, the creditors, and said, that's it, we can't. We can't. And the system crashes. Wow, it really crashed. In those last months of 2008, where I live in Manhattan and I know a lot of people who work in the financial district, there was real panic at the Federal Reserve building, at the Deutsche Bank building on Wall Street, all those famous places. They did not know whether this economy would survive. But it did survive. And how did it survive? It learned nothing from what had just happened, the collapse of credit. Nothing. The banks did understand you can't lend any more to the mass of people because they're deadbeats in this country. They can't pay. So you can't lend anymore. But you can lend to corporations, and you can lend to governments. And in fact, you better, because if you don't lend to them, nobody has the ability to buy anything. So starting in 2008, the same debt economy was developed, but not personal debt, not the debt of people like you, not mortgage, car payments, credit cards, and student debt. No. Government debt. The government was lent all the money, and it spent it. So we could go another few years from 2008 to now. Wow, and how was that arranged? First thing, the Federal Reserve brought the interest rates down to next to nothing. What does that do? It says to the government, hey, borrow. It doesn't cost anything. You can keep things going. It doesn't it says to corporations, hey, now's the time to borrow. Interest rates like 2% or 1% or 2.5%. This is wonderful. And the corporations borrowed and the governments borrowed. And we kept this dead horse running. We did. And who made it all possible in an ironic way? United States, Western Europe, Japan, borrowing, the governments like crazy, mostly the governments, the corporations, kept things going. But they didn't produce much because production had moved from those parts of the world. Production had moved to China. That's why you're all wearing Chinese outfits and toasting your bread in the morning in a Chinese toaster. You know, it's all China or India or Brazil or a few other places. And you know, when capitalism has a chance to make money, which the abandonment, leaving and going to China and those cheap worker places, that was exciting. You could make a lot of money. So the capitalists borrowed, here we go now, borrowed a ton of money to build all those factories in China. You take a look, any of you, at the history of China in the last 30 years, it's spectacular. There are cities there that are now full of skyscrapers that were empty fields 20 years ago. It's the greatest story of economic growth, period. No society has grown as fast, built its industrialization, as the People's Republic of China. A close second, but not as fast, was the Soviet Union. And I know it's popular to be critical of them, and I have my criticisms of them too. But if your measure is speed of economic growth, they win. But they won with enormous investments from the West. The borrowed money built up capacity to produce. Fantastic. Everybody borrowed and built up capacity. But capitalism is a system when that is never done in an orderly way. Every capitalist who could think of it said, oh, I'm going to close my factory in Cincinnati. I'm going to close it in Bakersfield. I'm going to open it in Shanghai. I'm going to open it over there. And maybe I'll keep my factory going in the United States a little bit, but I'll open the one over there because I can only compete if I have these workers that cost almost nothing. So the capacity to produce was enormous. And for a while, the Chinese had their industrialization, unprecedented, speedy, grow all that borrowed money around the world flooding into China to build up its industry. Spectacular. Only one problem. Capitalism always does this. It produced so much capacity at the same time that was crippling the capacity of people to buy the stuff. Because the wages were everywhere flat and the credit you couldn't get anymore. So the mass of people couldn't buy, even as the capitalists were building in their competitive frenzy the ability to produce. They produced the capacity, but there was no one to buy it. That's why, if you read in the newspaper, problems in China, which is a real silly argument. Is China having trouble? Absolutely. It's having trouble selling to the West. And the reason China is having trouble is because the West can't buy what was invested in to produce in China. But now the plot thickens. As the Chinese were building up over the last 25 years, stay with me, it's not that complicated, I promise. As the Chinese were building up, they needed energy, oil, because they don't have much. They needed raw materials, metals, and they went all over the world, they still do, trying to find all the inputs they needed for this industrial capacity to be built. And in every third world country, Asia, Africa, Latin America, here we go, capitalists borrowed at low interest rate, the money needed to build up the mining to ship that stuff to China. And it worked. They hired people and they brought up the stuff and they sold it to China. It all worked until it became time for the Chinese to begin to sell what they had this enormous capacity to produce, and they can't. There's no one to buy it. So the Chinese are slowing down. They can't, because they depend on the West, and the West is busy cutting its workers' wages and not lending them any money. If this all sounds crazy, you're right. You live in this crazy. This is your economic system. This is capitalism. That's how capitalism works. And that's why on Wall Street now, there is terrible anxiety, some of which is leaking into the financial press, that we're going to have another economic downturn now, this year, and if we do, it's a doozy, like the one in 2008, or maybe like the one in 2019-29. Who knows? But it's very scary. There's too much debt. This time, the fear isn't that the individual's debt will collapse, that we had that one in 2008. Now we're afraid that governments are going to collapse. You know, like Greece or others that are on the edge of collapse. Italy owes $4 trillion. No one believes they can get that money. And what's going to happen then? Nobody knows. Corporations can't pay. Let me give you another small example of the brilliance of capitalism. That was an attempt at humor. Just the brilliance of capitalism. It's really brilliant. And it's another sign of crisis. Because a mistake of the sort I just described, you could kind of see it, all these capitalists, they don't pay attention. Each one's trying to make a killing and move over to China. And you can see how it all adds up to something nobody wants, which is very capitalistic. But I'm going to give you another example, a little smaller and very American. 4 or 5 years ago, technology was developed that allows you to get oil that is stuck in shale in a certain kind of underground condition. We didn't used to have the capacity financially to pay for bringing that oil up. But with something called fracking that you've all heard about, I assume, that has horrible ecological and environmental consequences, I'm putting that aside for the moment. Clearly, capitalists don't give a et cetera about that. But I just want to focus you on the economics. But this technology was found, and oil companies got excited. We can get a ton of oil out of the ground. Very expensive, but at $100 a barrel, which is what it was for a bunch of years, oh boy, we can get this oil. Screw the environment, but we'll get the oil, and we'll sell it at $100 a barrel, and we'll make a fortune. So excited did they go, these geniuses who run the oil business in America, that they went to their fellow geniuses, the people who run big banks in America, and said, lend us the money so that we can buy the equipment to get the oil, and you'll get a cut of these wonderful profits. These smart bankers saw a deal when they heard about it, and they invested, ready? Hundreds of billions of dollars lending to the oil companies. Okay, now let's do what I did all my life. I taught economics, so I'm a professor of economics. In the first week of freshman economics, we teach students something called supply and demand. If some of you can stand it, go back in your memory to the first time someone taught that to you, painful I'm sure as it was. Here's how it works. If the supply of something goes up, the people want to sell more of it, but the demand doesn't, well, then the price falls. See, suppose there's 1,000 people come through the door all wanting to sell ice cream cones. Now, we all like ice cream cones, but we're not going to have a sudden massive increase in the desire for ice cream cones, there'd be no reason for it. So with all those people selling ice cream cones, the only way they're going to get sold is if they drop the price. The geniuses in the oil business, together with the geniuses in the banking business, never thought of it. Here's what they want. We're going to go in, we're going to bring up a vast amount of new oil, dump it on the world market at a time when China's slowing down and nobody else is doing anything. There's no reason to expect the demand for oil to go crazy. There's not even much reason to expect the demand for oil to stay that way. What it is. So if you increase massively the supply of oil and the demand goes nowhere, what do you think is going to happen? the price of oil, ready, is going to collapse, which in the last 18 months, it did. It went from $100 a barrel to about $30. That's what it is now. And guess what? All the oil companies are falling apart. All the banks, never going to get paid back. The oil company had no money. They're selling the oil at $30. They're losing money. They can't pay. Well, you laugh, and you should laugh. But shortly after laughing, you should start crying. Because you're going to pay for all of it. That's the way capitalism works. They make decisions looking to make money, and when it doesn't work out, you'll get screwed. Now, if you accept that, of course, it'll continue. Which is why it continues. Because we accept it. But it's a sign of fundamental crisis. Let me give you a second sign. The period before 2008 was a boom for capitalists. 1980, 2008, a generation, 28 years, really, they made a lot of money. Now, you can begin to see why, as I told you, that capitalists left the places where they had been born, the places where they had grown up, the places, by the way, that had subsidized them for generations with tax breaks, subsidies, designing the curriculum in the local schools so it would train the young people for the kinds of skills that those children would then have when they went to look for a job. And that's a support. The community supported these things. They would like us to think they were all self-made industrialists. There is no such thing. Every industrialist looks for help from the surrounding community all the time and usually gets it. But now, having gotten all those benefits and grown, they're leaving for lower wages and higher profits. Well, let's again do the supply and demand analysis. China, India, those were parts of the world that had little to do with capitalism until very recently. If they had any relationship at all, they produced some raw materials and some food and shipped them away, that was it. But when Western capitalists abandoned Western Europe, North America, and Japan, and moved to India and China, they brought a vast mass of new working people into the capitalist system. Hundreds of millions of Chinese people left the countryside of China, moved to the coast, that coastal area of China, from Beijing in the north to Shanghai in the south. And those hundreds of millions became workers in capitalist enterprises. Now use supply and demand. The supply of people looking for work from capitalist employers went up. But the demand of the capitalists didn't go up. They were just substituting workers in another country for the workers they abandoned here in the United States. So the demand for workers was more or less the same, but the supply went up. Guess what happens to wages when the supply goes up and the demand doesn't? The wages come down. The reason capitalists did well from 1980 to 2008, the years of profit, was not just that American workers borrowed, but that the wages that they paid everywhere in the world dropped because of this enormous increase in the supply. And suddenly, capitalists made out like bandits. They had a wonderful time. Oh, they would like you to believe it was because they were genius entrepreneurs. But as I've already shown you with illustration, genius really doesn't apply. An entrepreneur wasn't the name of the game. They didn't do well because they were entrepreneurs. They did well because they had collapsed the wage cost in the business by bringing millions more in from Asia, Africa, Latin America. No mystery, no great achievement, and nothing to do. I mean, I know we in America love to think about, I don't know, Steve Jobs and other technical. Yeah, those are interesting, those are significant, but they don't explain what's going on. Those are details. The fundamental issue is you don't pay workers anymore. You substitute somebody cheap in China for somebody expensive here, or in Europe, or in Japan. And the end result is the inequality in the world goes mad. I don't mean it gets worse. I mean it goes mad. 2 weeks ago, the Oxfam institution in Britain, one of the oldest and most respected research outfits and anti-poverty outfits in the world, been around a long time, issued their annual report. Two statistics, because it's almost unbearable. Here's the first statistic. The 62 richest persons in the world, individuals, 62 richest, today, as of the end of 2015, the 62 richest persons have more wealth, added up together, the 62, than the bottom half of the people on this planet, who number 3.5 billion. We have roughly 7 billion people on the planet. Let me do that again. The 62 richest people, most of whom are Americans, have more wealth than 3.5 billion, the lower half of the. You all get this? It's hard to get. How do you think about this? By the way, the lower half of the world's population are the people who have the worst illnesses, who die at the youngest age, who lose the most numbers of children in their first year. Every suffering you can think of is worst in the poor half. What would happen to them if the wealth of the 62 was taken from the 62 and it would double the wealth of the other, the 3.5 billion at the bottom, which would significantly affect their lives, their health, everything that matters. But we live in a capitalist system that has reproduced a level of inequality. You'd have to go back to the pharaohs of Egypt to get something like this. This is off the chart. Second statistic from Oxfam. The 1% richest in the world, the 1% richest, for the first time, and Oxfam has been keeping records for years, for the first time, the 1% richest together have more wealth than the other 99%. In other words, the 1% have more than half the wealth, and the other 99% share what remains, less than half. That's an achievement of capitalism. In a rational world, I would at this point stop talking, sit down, and the issue would be resolved. We would all have a vote and capitalism would cease. It is amazing that we permit it. It's also amazing that we don't logically see what some of the corollaries are. I wish I had more time to go through them with you. If you allow 62 people to have that grotesque wealth, and by the way, you know their names, Mr. Gates, Mr. Warren Buffett, you know, they're in the newspaper, they have a quasi-heroic status in our culture, these 62. Or if you knew about the 1% who have more wealth than the other 99, you'd know that those people, unless they were unspeakably stupid, and they aren't, you know that they would have long ago figured out, uh-oh, we have a wildly disproportionate amount of the wealth in a country that says to everybody, you get a vote. Because sooner or later, the mass of people being screwed by the economic system are going to figure out, let's use the political system where we have the majority to undo the effects of the economic system by, for example, taxing those folks like a lot, or having a minimum wage of $300 an hour or something like that. I'm more ambitious than the $15 an hour, okay? So they figured that out. So how do you prevent that? You buy the political system. Of course you do. You have to. Otherwise, you are self-destructive. So of course they buy. They buy the parties. They buy the candidate. They buy it all to make sure that that thing that could threaten them doesn't happen. It's like hiring a security service so someone doesn't break into your garage in the evening. Doesn't take genius, of course. So one of the corollaries is whatever was left of our political system is purchased by the same people who run the society. And you can pass a law, you can change it. And you here in California, you're doing yeoman work trying to get that done, getting money out of politics. But a famous saying of Yogi Berra, don't hold your breath. Those people have to do that, otherwise they are at risk. They're not going to, whatever you do, they will find a way out. You pass a law, they'll figure out a way. They have to do it illegally, they'll do it illegally. Okay. Inequality, instability of capitalism. Anxiety about the debt, going from one debt to the next debt, trying to hold the system. That's what it, this is chaos. This is an economy held together by spit and polish and a little bit of, you know, glue over here and a hope for this and maybe that. And no one knows from one day to the next. If you lived with a roommate as unstable as capitalism, you would have moved out long ago. This is a system that reaches into the refrigerator where you put the special kind of yogurt that you bought and they ate it and left a spoon in the empty container, which you found 2 days later with things growing on it that you can't describe. And you're upset. But the system is doing this to you all the time and you tolerate it. Lastly, when capitalism leaves its home, its American home, its French home, its Japanese home, and now becomes international. That, like inequality, has consequences, which we are all living with. I'm going to just give you two to give a sense of the crisis as it multiplies and kind of becomes like a cancer. It metastasizes everywhere. First, the joke I made earlier, that all of your clothes come from far away. Think what that means. Once upon a time, your T-shirt, your underpants, your socks, your gloves came from someplace 100 miles away, 200 miles away. Now, it comes 10,000 miles away. Some ship has to pollute the air, pollute the water. The level of contamination is the wastage of fossil fuel. Spectacular. Why? Because more profitable for capitalists to produce it there. The cause of the pollution is capitalism. You gotta see that, otherwise you're gonna start blaming individuals for not recycling their bottles. That's not the issue. The issue is a capitalism that works this way. But there's a second corollary. If your production system isn't local, if it's international, then the profit-making companies that are now spread all over the world, they need to be protected all over the world. They can't be satisfied with an army and a navy and an air force at home. They have to have that in place to protect the shipping lanes that come from China to here. They have to protect the factories that are now more located in China than they are here. They have to have an army and a military that's busy everywhere, figuring out how to forestall the next trouble that could interfere with what they've come to depend on economically. You know, when you reorganize the world economy the way capitalism has, it causes a lot of disruption in the world. Parts of the world are suddenly interesting for oil, and so the cultures that have been there are disturbed. Ways of living that people used to have, they can't do that anymore. Large parts of Central Asia, large parts of Southeast Asia have been transformed in recent years by all the change. And those people are suffering, and they don't want these changes, and they don't understand half of what's going on, and they lash out. But that could threaten all of these new international, so we have to have the army everywhere. As our leaders tell us, we have to have endless war. Endless war. We go into Libya, and then we go out of Libya, and then yesterday we said we're apparently going back into Libya. What? Libya? I won't embarrass you by asking you to spell Libya. Right? Americans, we have a real interest in Libya. Most people have no clue. But we're going to go to war. Or the other obscenity. We go to war. There are now five countries bombing. And if you look on a map, Syria is a very small place. Russia, America, France, Britain, I may be missing one, are bombing Syria. Bombing them relentlessly while a civil war is going on among a multiplicity, not just two, but a multiplicity of warring. A small country bombed by the biggest powers in the world with a civil war. It's not a good place to be. So millions of people figuring that out as they watch their family get blown to smithereens, leave, and they go to nearest place that's safe, Europe. And Europe is now discussing whether they have a moral obligation to take them. We don't have that discussion in the United States because our morality is clear. We ain't taking any. The Europeans, the ones bombing, are worried about the morality of taking a refugee. You got to stop, folks. You're at a level of craziness now that is a sign of a society that's fallen apart. It's not this or that. It's the accumulation of all of these. And then there are the little, and I'll stop with this on the crisis. I want to turn to change. But they're little ones, too. They're not really little, but they're micro level. And I know these things have happened in the past, but they're happening with a frequency and an intensity that is new. Every major automobile capitalist in the world is killing us. You know that in the last year. Everyone, they either kill us with those Takata airbags that blow up and send shrapnel through your neck at no extra charge. That VW, which systematically installed equipment that would fool the machines that measure how much pollution you're doing so that they could sell millions and millions of cars that caused countless emphysema deaths in the world. They put, it's all on record, it's all there. All there. General Motors, it didn't tell us for 10 years about the ignition problems that they had in the car that caused, I believe the current number is 150 deaths and thousands of injuries, or maybe more, yeah, whatever it is. At first it was none, then it was 20, and you know, that's the game. Car companies, all of them, have had a conspiracy now for years to kill us. It's profitable. It's very clear. It's to make money. They would take a risk with our lives. Makes perfect sense. Then there's that fast food chain that gets everybody sick. I don't know how to pronounce that word. Chipotle? Yeah. I don't mean to single them out, although I'm perfectly happy doing it. But they are in trouble. I believe they're closing their store one day this week to have a big focus on cleanup. Makes you wonder what they did all the other days. Well, cleaning up. I recently did a piece on the radio about the fight of the food processing companies against the new FDA attempt to regulate the quantity of added sugar. Turns out that most of the products in the supermarket that you buy have sugar added to them. Not the natural sugar that's in them as part of their biology. I'm talking about adding sugar. Right? If I remember, you're supposed to have no more than 13 teaspoons of added sugar per day in your food. One can of Coca-Cola is 9 teaspoons. You probably didn't know that. When you drink a glass of Coke, you have 9 teaspoons of sugar. Well, turns out this sugar is a cause of diabetes and obesity. And we have serious problems in our country with both those conditions. So the FDA wanted to demand, tough our FDA, that you put on the label how many teaspoons of sugar you added. No rule that you can't add them, just tell people. And the food companies are fighting it, and so far they're winning. So we won't know how we are What? What kind of, what? What is this? And then the drugs. The last few days, a wonderful hearing of Mr. Shkreli there, where he sits and laughs at these congressmen and women who are yelling at him for jacking up the prices of drugs. That's a scandal of all kinds of drugs. Goes together with a story a couple weeks ago about drug shortages all over the United States that have put the hospitals and clinics and doctors in a terrible position. Turns out if there's a drug shortage, you got too many people, you haven't got enough drugs, you got to decide who gets it and who doesn't. And it turns out that all over the country this is being done, often telling the people who don't get one that there aren't any. Well, you will start looking at it and you find out what is the reason that it's not there. And the answer, the drug companies tell you, it's not profitable to make those drugs. Okay, that's capitalism. You want a drug, it has to be profitable. You don't pay enough, you don't get it. You may be sick, but if you can't pay, have a nice death. You're done. It's amazing. But unlike my other speeches, I can now also talk to you about signs of change. Because having said all of this, the level of change in the United States now is unlike anything I have seen in my lifetime. And that is very, very important for us all to understand. Because there are many forces in this culture that don't want that perception to become widespread. And we can all figure out why that might be. But let's review it. Everywhere in the world, not just the United States, there is a massive political turning away from the old political establishment. It's very important to see. The old political parties, the old political candidates, the old political language, the old political theater everywhere isn't working. People are turning away from it. I'm going to give you just three examples. One, Greece, that poor country with all it's gone through. For many years, Greece had two political parties. New Democracy was the name of one, and the Greek Socialist Party was the name of the other. And they together got about three quarters of the vote, a little bit like our Republican and Democrats. And they exchanged, you know, one period. One had the prime minister and the next one. The other one had the prime minister. Everything was very understandable. They intermarried and all the rest. They did. They literally did. It didn't matter. It didn't matter. Or a lot of Greeks are radical when they're young, and then they mature and become whatever the other is. Okay? Then in 2012, it stopped. That's it. Because Greece went through harder times sooner than the rest of the Western world, they abandoned those parties. Those parties together now can't get a quarter of the vote. Before, they had three quarters of the vote. A little party, Syriza, had 3 or 4% of the vote, is now the government. A left-wing party, by the way, quite left-wing. That's amazing. I'm going to give you another example, which I suspect most of you don't know. That a month and a half ago, the government of Portugal changed. The current government of Portugal is an alliance between the Portuguese Socialist Party, the Portuguese Communist Party, and the Portuguese Green Party. Shall I do that again? And if you didn't read about it, think what that means. You didn't read about it. Very important. Earth-changing for Portugal. Very important for neighboring Spain, where much the same thing has happened. The two biggest cities in Spain, Madrid and Barcelona, now both have unheard of things. They have communist women mayors, both cities. Jeez. And if you didn't know that, think about that. Think about what that might mean, that none of this is in your mind. I hear other signs that the old politics doesn't work. Trump. Cruz. Because whatever else you think about them, and I'm not here to endorse or not endorse, and I'm not doing that. But Trump and Cruz, that's something else. That's not what it's been. Other politicians don't think they can say such things. It's beyond the pale. It's out, but not for them. They too understand, even though they want to take it in a different direction, that the old is dying, that the old isn't holding on, that the old is associated with that capitalism that is breaking down and that people somehow feel is breaking down. And then the one that, of course, I would assume most of you find remarkable, and boy, you should, Bernie Sanders. Why is Bernie Sanders important? Well, in a way you know, but I want to underscore something here because it's so important. For the last 65 years, the United States has lived with a kind of taboo, an unspoken rule that you cannot seriously talk about socialism ever anywhere without committing political suicide and possibly other kinds of suicide, depending on which part of the country and exactly who you're talking to, right? For 65 years, roughly 1945 to roughly now, you couldn't. A job was done on the American people, the likes of which you have almost nowhere else in the world can you find, this level of repression. Spectacular. And not a repression that killed a lot of people. It's interesting. Other places in the world, they kill a lot of people. We didn't do that here. There were a couple, you know, the Rosenbergs, folks like that. But in the main, you didn't kill them. And you jailed a bunch, but not that many. And you deported an even larger bunch, but not that many either. You did it ideologically. You made it impossible to take it seriously. Nobody could talk about it. Bernie Sanders is the end of that. It's over. And all of you should take a real deep breath. This country has changed. It's over. This nightmare in which every other European country has Socialist Party, Communist Party, has discussions about socialism and communism every day in the newspaper, has survived, still has restaurants and camps and subways run, and you can get a tomato. It's not a problem. Many of the governments, the French government today is completely socialist. The German government is a partner of the conservatives and the socialists, and on and on and on and on and on. Only in this country, well, socialism would be the end of everything. What? What? And Bernie Sanders figured out, God knows how, that this is the moment he got something. He had his finger, his pulse or something. Let him have the crazy idea. Now, the underlying confidence in capitalism is weakened enough that out I can come. I won't run away from the name socialism. Yep, that's me. I'm one. And it will not destroy him, which he thought it might, which the Clintons obviously assumed it would, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It didn't. He knows that he's riding on some kind of wave he barely understands. I know he knows it, because I know it too, about me. I'm on my radio program is on 50 stations across the United States now. What's that about? And they all came to me. I don't have the resources to go to them. They came to me. What's that about? What is that about? Something has happened. Telling the truth, a lot of us thought we were doing for quite some time. People looked at us as if we fell off a truck or came from the moon or were, you know, evil, disloyal weirdos. Suddenly, we're professor this or that. You know, and Professor used it a sort of complimentary way, as much as that ever gets compliments. I'm a professor, so like it, you ought to listen to me or something like that. But that's not about me. I haven't changed that much. It's about the audience. That's what's changed. It's you. It's the larger American people. Occupy Wall Street took an amazing step in that direction by daring, the first left movement from below that dared to put the economic stuff right up front. 1%, 99%. By the way, a brilliant anticipation of the statistics that came later. But the most important thing about them was that suddenly we all saw in 300 cities around the United States, those kids putting up the tents in the little downtown park, and not just kids either. So we suddenly knew we weren't quite as small as we had been led to believe. We weren't quite as few. And that prepared the way for Bernie Sanders, who's teaching us that there we aren't thousands, we're millions. Half the people who voted in the Democratic primary, actually a bit more than half the people who voted in the Democratic primary, voted against Hillary Clinton. They either voted for Bernie, that's 99% of them, and then 1%, I know he had a name, I've forgotten it. I'm being mean. The ex-governor of Maryland, I believe, who's dropped out since. That's amazing. That is an amazing thing. The people of Iowa, not a leading radical state. Half the people of Iowa were not dissuaded one bit that this man is a socialist. It didn't matter. But here's a statistic which, if you want a reason to go home with a smile on your face, in case you didn't catch it, they did polling to identify who voted for whom. And one of the categories was voters of the age of 18 to 29, youngest group. They voted 84% for Sanders, 14% for Clinton. Wow. That's the future. That's also a statement that for those people, the Cold War has about the same immediate relevance as the Peloponnesian War. They know it happened. They know what the two sides were. But beyond that, they're not interested. They don't care. Maybe if someone gives them a long speech about it, they'll listen and it might be interesting. But nah. And they're not really motivated, to be honest with ourselves. They're not motivated by socialism. Because the truth of it is, I gave a talk, by the way, about a few months ago at Ames, Iowa. I was invited to the University of Iowa State, I believe it is, that's there. And it was very clear, a big audience, bigger than this one, and very nice, very welcoming. But the honest truth is that the young people ask questions, and the questions reduce to the following. What is socialism? And because they're young people, they were honest. That's what they wanted to know. They didn't have the feeling yet they must not show that they don't know. That takes an adult to get to that point. They were clear, and they asked, and I'm very pleased when they asked because it gives me a chance to answer in my utterly unbiased manner on this subject. So they didn't vote for Bernie because he's a socialist. So why did they vote for him? Good news. They voted for him because they don't like the status quo. They've had it with this. They don't buy it anymore. They don't accept it anymore. And a politician who looks, smells, tastes like another one of those who has for all this time been justifying, rationalizing, and excusing the status quo, they don't want them. Mrs. Clinton has not figured this out yet. And that's why she's in trouble, because she keeps presenting an old politician in style, in rhetoric, in tone. Partly she's stuck with that husband. Well, it's true. She's stuck politically. I mean, She has other problems, no doubt, but we're polite and we're not going to go in that direction. But I'm talking politically because he was the poster boy for this sort of thing. He was the president when everybody was borrowing money, and he was a leading pretender that this was a wonderful economy. It wasn't. It was built on a credit mountain that fell apart, that he canceled the Glass-Steagall Act, that he passed a welfare reform that was a disaster for millions of people, and on and on and on. She has to live, unfortunately, with that, with the name and all the associations. But it is a sign that the taboo on socialism is over in the United States. And that's going to make everything most of you are interested in seeing happen in this country happen easier and happen sooner. That's an amazing thing. Something must be going on, because you can't thank Bernie. I mean, he's done a wonderful job of his campaign, heaven knows. But that's not, he didn't achieve that. He's the beneficiary of something. And it's that something. Capitalism is teaching its own people to turn against it. The best recruiter for Bernie Sanders is the system he's criticizing. The best thing that's happened to socialism in half a century is capitalism. But that's very good news, because then the prediction that socialism is past is revealed for what it always was: wishful thinking. Socialism will never disappear because it is capitalism's own self-criticism. It always was. Capitalism produced Karl Marx. If you ever read his stuff, you'll see that. He was just reacting emotionally and intellectually to a capitalism that horrified him. And most of what I've just spent, you know, almost an hour telling you is to make you able, if you aren't already, to be horrified by what you're sitting through, what you're seeing around you. How many Flint, Michigan, destruction of children who will suffer all their lives for having drunk this lead-filled water? I mean, how many of these do we have to have before we blow up as a society? Let me bring this to a conclusion then. Is there a solution? And I know that here's a problem. And I'm going to be speaking at another auditorium in this college tomorrow at 2 o'clock, where I'm going to spend a lot more time on this question of solution and the history of socialism and what it all means. But among the other things that have changed over the last 40 years, as I say, I'll do more of this tomorrow. I don't have time tonight. But I want to make it clear to you is socialism has changed dramatically. And the basic reason socialism has changed is that the early experiments with socialism, the Soviet Union and the People's Republic of China, most important, were just that. They were early experiments in socialism. There are things you have to learn from those experiments, things that are good you want to copy. And there are things you have to learn that are horrible that you don't ever want to do again. Yeah? And a creative person who goes through an experience that has goods and bad, that's what we do. That's what you do. You try to figure out, how do we preserve what was achieved, and how do we overcome what has shown itself to be a dead end or worse? Socialists have been doing that. Not all socialists. Some haven't. A lot of socialists stopped being socialists. They couldn't cope with what happened in those countries. It was just the end of an illusion for them, or the end of a dream. And that's sad. But we're going to get those people back as the winds shift. But I want to talk to you for a minute about the socialism that has changed, the self-criticism socialists went through. And again, to make what I'm going to do in details tomorrow brief for you here, it's an important way to end. Socialists, and here, to be honest, I'm not sure what I'm about to describe includes Bernie Sanders. We will see. But for the moment, I want to talk about the socialists who went through a change. And here's how the change works. We made a mistake. A lot of things we did were good. You know, providing universal health care for everybody and free education for everybody and guaranteed housing that could not rise above a certain minimum percentage of your annual income. A lot of things that the socialist experiments did were very good. I know this is hard for an American audience, but that's true everywhere in the world except here. the French, for example. My family's French. I know a lot about France. I've spoken French since I was a baby, etc. In France, the socialists achieved a law decades ago. And the law says the minute you become a paid worker, you finish high school or you finish college and you go into the labor force, the minute you get a job anywhere in France, the law requires your employer to give you 5 weeks of paid vacation. If you didn't know that, there's another piece of evidence about something. That's the law. That's, by the way, typical in Europe. It's not just France. It's all over Europe. More of 4 weeks here, 5 weeks there. So let me do that again. 5 weeks paid vacation. After the socialists got it, occasionally when conservative governments replaced the socialists, they began to make noises about doing away with that. That took about 3-4 minutes. At which point the population informed the conservative government that they'd be out of office so fast that they better not even think about it, which is why it has been on the books with conservative governments and socialist governments. Doesn't make any difference. It's like in England. You can't touch the National Health Service. You can play around at the edge, but you can't. Socialized medicine, you bet, we want it. In France, there's a supplement. After your first child, if you have two or three of one, the government gives you a subsidy for each child to help pay for the cost of feeding and clothing and educating your child. Child is a resource of the society and is to be supported. If you didn't know that, oh. I once was a visiting professor at the University of Paris, number one. The University of Paris has a whole bunch of campuses. And I was at University of Paris number one, which has another name called the Sorbonne, an old name of the French university. So I had to be enrolled as a professor. All universities in France are public. Let me do this again. All universities are public. Why don't they have private universities? If you ask them, they look at you in stunned horror and they explain to you, well, if you had private universities and public, then it would be a two-track system, and that's not consistent with democracy. What's the matter with you? You don't ask that question a second time because the looks they give you is really like you just insulted their grandmother or something. So they don't have that. Not only is everything public, but I was astonished to discover with my colleagues when we would have lunch. And one of the most important reasons to be a professor in France is to have lunch. Because then you discover what lunch can be. Anyway, I discovered over lunch two things that I'll never forget. First, I discovered what the students pay for the university. It's to this day, it's still around $300-$400 a semester. Let me do that again. It's about $300-$400 a semester. That's it. That covers it. They, of course, don't have a medical coverage fee because if you're in France, you get that anyway. You don't need that. Gee. Then I discovered that my colleagues at the time, one of them had a lovely young daughter. She was 7 years old, named Sandrine, a common name in French. And Sandrine went to the daycare center in the premier arrondissement, the first little district in the center of Paris. And she went, she could go as early as 7 in the morning, she could stay as late as 7 in the evening, and or any portion thereof, and they would feed her, and they had a nurse on staff, and they had a teaching program. It was wonderful. And I asked, what does it cost? 17 euros a week. That's about 20 bucks. And his salary, the professor, about the same as mine here. He's the same salary in France, but the education of his children won't cost him anything. And the daycare for his little kids don't cost him anything either. His standard of living is way higher than mine as a result. He pays more for his food. On the other hand, the food he gets. Okay. The socialists learned in their self-criticism something that is as crucial as anything I can leave you with tonight. We made a mistake, they said, they've concluded. We didn't understand that giving to the government the power to own and operate industry and the power to plan the distribution of goods and services. Because remember, in classical socialism, what capitalism is private enterprise and markets. And what socialism is public enterprise and government planning. That's the way, for example, to this day, the New York Times thinks like that. They don't know anything about the self-criticism of socialism. Why would they? They've banned the subject in this country for 40 years. You'd have to pay attention to the developments of socialism everywhere else in the world, and nobody on the staff of the New York Times, as far as I can tell, does that. There's certainly no indication in their writing. So these socialists, and there are many of them, concluded you can't go that way. You can't do that. That lends itself to too much power in a concentrated place that destroys a whole other part of what the socialist dream always was, which was freedom, which was freedom of expression, which were all those things which the Soviet Union and the People's Republic of China didn't do real well on. And that has to be understood. Why? What do we learn as socialists? We're not people who throw away the whole socialist experiment because that was done badly. That kind of logic would mean you'd have to throw away capitalism too, given the horrible things it's done. You don't think like that because it's childish. Well, then how do you deal with this? Well, the socialists have come up with an answer. And the answer is you cannot and you need not think that socialism only means the government steps in where the private was before. That's an unnecessary either-or proposition. Socialists should have nothing to do with it. It isn't socialism if you get rid of the private capitalists who tell you what to do all day when you work and substitute state officials who tell you what to do all day. This is not what the dream was about. Well, what then is it? And the answer is that they're coming to, and I'm going to give you examples when I conclude, that to make a society serve the people in it, you have to have an economy that serves the people in it. And the only way that an economy will serve the people in it is if the people are in charge. You cannot have a small group of people, is the socialist conclusion. Whether that small group are wealthy investors, major shareholders, boards of directors, owners, that's one small group, that's what we got, or you get rid of them and you stick in another small group of government officials. This is not the solution. Whatever the virtues and faults of these two alternatives are, they have something in common. They've left a tiny group of people to run the show economically. And if you have a tiny group of people who run the show, there's a damn good chance they're going to run it for them and not for everybody else. So you got to put everybody else in a position where that can't happen. And how do you do that? So far, the socialist answer is you've got to change the way the enterprise, the place where goods and services are produced, how it's organized. It can't anymore be the few people at the top who make the decision. Think about where you work. You go to an office or a store or a factory. You walk in, you take off your jacket, you put on whatever outfit you are, and you sit wherever they tell you to sit, with whatever equipment they tell you to work with, doing whatever they tell you to do in whatever way they tell you to do it. And at the end of the day, when you've finished pouring out your creativity, your muscles, your brains into it, you go home and you leave behind whatever it is you helped to produce, which they, who've told you how to do it, where to do it, when to do it, they will decide how to dispose of it. And if there's a profit to be made, they'll decide what to do with it. Your job is to help make the profit. You got crap to say about what happens to what you did. That is the micro level of what then the society reproduces as a whole. A tiny group of people make the decisions. Whether you call them government officials or the big cheeses of the corporations, they make the decision because you've set the frame, you've accepted it everywhere where goods and services are produced. And that's crucial because that's where most adults spend most of their lives. 5 out of 7 days, 9 to 5, you go to work. And if that work is organized in a hierarchical, undemocratic way, precisely where a few people make the decisions you all have to live with, where average people do not participate, one person, one vote, in making the decisions, you can hardly be surprised that you don't live in a democratic society, because your economic life, which is where you spend most of your time, is organized in an anti-democratic manner. So socialism becomes the demand, the advocacy for a transition from top-down capitalist organized enterprises to worker cooperatives. That is the argument that socialists are coming to. That way, the government, whatever it is going to be beholden not to the corporations the way it is now, but to the collectives of working people who will be owning and operating all the enterprises on which the government's revenue and the government's legitimacy becomes dependent. That's the idea. Bernie Sanders, interestingly, mostly focuses on having the government do more. It's a more traditional socialism. It's the truth. But he has in his economic platform a big statement about wanting to support worker co-ops. I take that to be a sign that this idea is filtering into his center too. But the greatest example, and this is my conclusion for you, is actually in Britain. And this, for those of you who know something about Britain, this may come as a shock or a surprise. The British Labour Party had a little revolution of its own a few months ago. This is a party epitomized by basically, you know, Bill Clinton, only he was called, I blocked his name, Blair. Isn't that interesting? My wife's a psychotherapist. I'm going to have to ask her why I did that. Tony Blair. And Tony Blair, Gordon Brown, a series of these people have run the Labour Party, so it looks a lot like the Democratic Party, you know, Bill Clinton and all that. And they had an election a few months ago, in the middle of last year, for the new leader of the party, because in the last election, the Labour Party took a terrible beating. And a Bernie Sanders, by the name of Jeremy Corbyn. You're going to hear more about him. C-O-R-B-Y-N, Corbyn, Jeremy Corbyn. To the surprise of everybody, won. He's the new leader of the Labour Party. The Labour Party is the number two party in Great Britain. I mean, there's a good chance in any national election that he will be the next Prime Minister of Great Britain, which is not a minor matter. How did he win? By enrolling 200,000 new members of the Labour Party, all of whom, or virtually all of whom, are young. Uh-oh. Now it's more like Bernie Sanders. And he's in favor of all the kinds of things Bernie Sanders is. He is a Bernie Sanders. But here's the thing that blew me away when I saw it. The person that he would make one of the highest officials in the government if he wins the election, John McDonnell by name, made a statement about 3 weeks ago in which he said, and I want you to listen to this, please, that we have to change what the thrust of our politics is. Yes, we are committed to re-nationalizing the railroads. One of the things Maggie Thatcher and the others did was to privatize, you know, the conservative. Well, he's committed to, no, end of that. But he said, we are no longer going to make a priority out of nationalization. Instead, he said, the new priority for the Labour Party, if we get into power, is to build and support worker cooperatives as an alternative way of organizing economy and society. And then he went into specifics, showing that the Labour Party has done some work. Here's what he proposed. We want to encourage entrepreneurs. Funny if he should use that word. You know, entrepreneur, it's a French word. It comes from the entre and prendre, two French words. You put them together. It actually means literally an undertaker. The association between an entrepreneur and an undertaker is one I want you to think about. Okay? But in French, and the British don't like the French real well. It has something to do with the different level and quality of cuisine, I think. But in any case, in French, the entrepreneur, he says, the entrepreneur, we want to encourage entrepreneur. If you have some new invention, if you have some new way of doing it, we want you to put together some people, build an industry. That's how society can improve and productivity. It's fine. We have no problem with it. But when you're done, when you have decided to no longer work on this business because you want to do something else, or you've gotten old, you wish to retire, before you can sell it to anyone, and before you can go public, I just make it a public company by issuing shares of stock, we will, Labor Party, draft a law that the first thing that you have to do, the right of first refusal it's called, is you must offer to the workers in your business the opportunity to buy the business and run it as a collective, cooperative enterprise. And the government will finance the loan to the workers to enable them to do it and provide them with technical assistance and purchase their products on behalf of the government. And the rationale will be that for 300 years, governments have supported, subsidized, helped, and encouraged capitalist business. It's long past time that the government start playing even, an even playing field. It's time to support worker cooperatives in all the different ways. Let's develop a big worker cooperative sector so that the people can decide whether they want to buy from a top-down, hierarchical, undemocratic capitalist enterprise or a worker cooperative. If they want a job, do they want to work in a top-down, hierarchical, or do they want to work? And says Mr. McDonald with a grin, we're not real worried about which way they'll choose. Well, what this shows is a level, this idea is becoming concretized. This idea is being worked into tangible, specific things that can be done. These are signs of change. This is the maturity of a socialist self-criticism coupled with the creative application of socialist ideas to a way forward, to another kind of society. Another way to try to realize socialism that learns from the old ones what they had that they did well and what they did badly. If we want to keep government planning, okay, but it's going to have to be controlled by cooperatives from the base. And we still have to work out how does the collective decision of all the workers become co-respective with the communities in which those enterprises exist. Because what the community does affects the enterprise. What the enterprise does affects the community. That has to be worked out. Now we work it out that the undemocratic enterprise negotiates with the more or less democratic community. Now we will have a new world in which a community will become a dealer with a democratically organized enterprise. Revolutions are not made because people have a clear idea of what the alternative is. That's never happened. When the American made a revolution against the British, they said, we want independence. What the hell did that mean? No one knew what that meant. They didn't make a revolution because they had a clear idea of what independence was. If you read any of it, Sam Adams or Thomas Jefferson, they had the vaguest idea what was going to happen. What they knew was the existing thing was intolerable. They couldn't stand King George III. They didn't want this anymore. It was unbearable. Revolution, the French Revolution, they had a clear idea of where French society would go? Not at all. They hated Marie Antoinette. And you know what happened to her. Right? They hated all of that. Americans are moving to a situation, which is why I set up my talk the way I did. The changes that are coming, they're not coming out of clear ideas of what socialism is or where it's going to go. They're coming out of the intolerability of what exists and the loss of confidence that the people who are leaders have a clue how to get out of here, of this situation. And they're turning to Bernie Sanders because he may not have a clue, but he's not giving them the same old junk that they get from everybody else. These are signs of fundamental change in the United States. And I hammer at it with this final parting thought. We on the collective left, I hope the ACLU is comfortable with, and for that matter, Occidental too. We on the collective left, I'm just speaking for myself, of course. We on the collective left have a reasonably good excuse that over the last 50, 60 years, during that time of the terrible taboo that has now ended, that we held back, we felt unloved, we felt unlistened to, we felt it dangerous to say much, except to a few people that we trusted who shared our ideas or at least cared for us enough not to rat us out. So we were hesitant and we were quiet and we were shy and we were reticent. And that was an understandable adjustment to the realities we faced. I understand it. But the reason I want to hammer at the incredible changes that are going on is that if we continue to be hesitant, we are missing a great historical moment. We now have to learn from what Bernie did and what the Occupy people did. They took a step. And it's the old joke, they ran the flag up the pole, and it turns out a lot of people saluted, which means it's the right flag, it's the right time. Now what is needed is that all of you start talking. Shoot your mouth off every chance you get. Because there's a world out there that is more willing to hear what you have to say than it has been in half a century. And if we don't take advantage of this moment, we don't know when or whether it will come again. It's really up, we have no excuse now. The government is busy chasing Muslims. And Mexicans. And building walls. It doesn't understand where its problems lie because it can't let itself see that. And that is an enormous advantage for us. This is the time to move. I travel around the United States. Let me pull this last point on you. I'm going from here. I talk here tomorrow at the Mosher Auditorium. At 2 o'clock. Then I go to Berkeley. I speak in the First Congregational Church. It's a church that holds 700 people. It is full. Then I go to Sonoma. I speak in the Sonoma. I thought I spoke in the Sonoma Community Center, but it's not. In some other place in Sonoma. And then I come back at the end of the month and speak in San Jose and San Luis Obispo. The following month, I am the annual guest, I don't remember the exact title, I'm going to mess this up. Anyway, I'm going to the University of Kentucky. Yeah, the University of Kentucky. They have invited me, they know who I am. They've been very gracious and very friendly, and I'm looking forward to going to the University of Kentucky, and on and on and on. 2 months ago, I went to Washington State, spoke in Seattle and Bellingham and Bothell, which is a suburb, if I understand it, of Seattle. University of Washington, University of Seattle, University of Western Washington. All big auditoriums filled with very excited students, and all of that before the Bernie phenomena really caught on. So God knows what I would get if I went there now. I expect, even to this day, opposition, skepticism, it's not there. It's just not there. it's been, I mean, buried in the minds of folks. I'm sure there's some skepticism and some doubt, of course. But basically, people are in a kind of suppressed euphoria because they sense something. And I just want to make it stronger in you. I want to give it a name. I want to give it a description. So whatever bits of that euphoria are in you, get encouraged. Because this moment historically needs all of us to be active, needs all of us to get in there and seize this time. Because it's precious. I don't know how long it'll last. And it's also possible things will get much, much worse very quickly this year. And then it'll become urgent, not just an important thing, but really urgent, that our side plays a role. Otherwise, we will leave it to Ted Cruz or Donald Trump or those others. You've been a very patient audience. Thank you very much. All right.